trying to fill your passenger seat with chat about classic cars, all recorded from my 1968 Morris Minor Peggy. I'm Becca, and today I'm making the trip down to pick up my partner from work, having finished work myself. The trip is actually going to be taking place on a little section of the A1M, and it seemed like the perfect time to do a little podcast about motorways, the history and design of motorways that actually almost coincides with the history of cars like Peggy becoming ever so popular. My quirk of classic car ownership for you today is how easily we can be made to smile by seeing another classic car owner out on the roads. I've actually fortunately seen two other classic car owners out today. One has actually started bringing their car to work, so alongside the Citroen Lomax that I've spoken about before, another guy has started bringing his Ford Cortina Mark 1 to work to give it a little bit of a run as well. And as well as that, when I went to fill up with petrol just before I started this podcast, saw a very lovely example of, I think, some sort of 80s Mercedes-Benz convertible in a very stunning red colour that was certainly drawing a lot of attention in the petrol station. And also, actually, along this stretch of road not that long ago, I saw a Hillman Hunter that was certainly a regularly used car because of the fact that it was kind of very well worn and used and loved and was laden up with lots of the sorts of things you'd expect to see in a car that somebody was using regularly. So it's always nice to see not only another classic car out on the road, even when you're in your moderns, to be honest, but also one that is starting to get a bit more frequent use, potentially as a daily driver as well.
Push that happened post World War II in both
back to making cars, the production was now cheaper. They developed a lot of technologies during the war for things like aeroplanes and tanks and other war machinery that meant that driving would actually be more accessible to a larger spread of people. Previously, driving had really been a luxury of middle classes and upwards, but we could start to see cars being developed, much like the Morris Minor, in this post-world period for many more of your every man to have this access to transport. And so the first motorway, after years of deciding on the layouts and the plans and things like that, was the M1. Surprisingly, but given its name, obviously the first motorway. And it was really very critically acclaimed when it was introduced. The first section of the M1 opens in 1959, so only 10 years after the introduction of the very first Morris Minor, and it's designed for the cars that are at the time. M1 in its original state was seeing your cars like your Morris Minors and things making their way up and down it. And they were doing so in a way that was unseen for cars prior to this. It was very much a glamorised, low traffic, no speed limit space to really enjoy your car. So some people, even though the roads were new and perhaps scary, were just making a day trip out of going on the motorway. And even if you didn't own a car, these new ways of transporting yourself around the country were drawing a lot of interest. As well as cars going on an average of 80 miles per hour up and down these roads to test out the real capabilities of their cars, because in these early days there was no speed limits on them, people were making a day trip of going and watching the traffic on the M1. So people were sitting on the verges, on bridges, even in the hard shoulder, taking picnics and sitting there for the day and watching people travel up and down the roads in their cars at speeds that they'd never really seen before. There was even bus trips organised out of London to the M1 for people to go and see these things, and also to potentially experience the M1 in a bus if they didn't own a car themselves, that might then persuade them that this new glamorous, very free and open way of travelling would be for them, and they might be convinced to buy a car, which is just such an interesting, complete opposite to how a lot of us now view motorways. Many of us associate motorways with congestion and traffic and so many cars and just poorly designed ins and outs and things like that. And actually the very early forms of plans for the motorways was to offer something new, exciting, and was going to make driving and travelling around our country post-war in a much more an exciting and thrilling way. And a lot of thought went into the designing of these roads to make them, despite the fact that there was no speed limits and stuff like that, as safe as possible for individuals who were travelling on them. So one of the big things that came out of this was actually the signage that we see at the sides of the roads today. A lot of the signage is very similar to what happened in this post-war period when we were really considering the signs that we had around the country. For a really long time, our signage had been the same signage that we'd had for hundreds of years on little tiny back roads and things like that. Little kind of milestones at the sides of the road that showed you literally how many miles there were to the next place. And that wasn't going to work when people were potentially travelling at speeds that cars hadn't really travelled at before. You weren't going to really notice a tiny little stone at the side of the road and be able to understand what that meant, and things like that. So they started to actually think about, well, what can we do to improve our signage? So internationally, this was being noted as a problem, and in 1949, we have a Geneva protocol introduced about what we need our signs to do and what they need to be able to offer us on these new roads that we were designing at the same sort of time. And so there tends to be, as with anything like this, a lot of meetings, a lot of discussions, a lot of committees being held, and it takes until 1962 for our first kind of road signs to be presented. And given that we were now starting to see more people travelling internationally and the realisation that our world was becoming smaller, we needed these signs to not only be decided upon in country, but we needed signs that were going to be somewhat similar between different nations, so that if we went over the border to France, we would know where we were and we would know how to get them to where we needed to be. And this is something, again, that the war had really highlighted, that when we went over to other countries, we were struggling to find our way around, which had worked in the favour of some situations, but had made other operations quite difficult. And so a group of designers within the UK that were led by one gentleman who is often overlooked and remains kind of forgotten within history books, and that is Jock Kinnear. Apologies if I'm mispronouncing that, but he set about with his group of designers designing and testing endlessly throughout that period between the Geneva Protocol in 1949 and 1962, when we start to see our first signs introduced, measuring, working out distances, working out what's going to work well, working out if different fonts work better, and contrasts in colours. So the biggest contrast that was needed was on the motorways that were now being introduced. And so that is why on motorways we have this blue and white contrast, because it was deemed to be the most effective for noticing the difference, but also from a further distance as well. So you're able to make out the lettering and things like that from a much further distance than any other colour combination, based on Jock Kinnear's team's research. They also tried out whether block capitals would be a better option, and they tried out whether having a different font would be better, different spacing, and in the end they came to the conclusion that the letters of the smallest size needed to be at least 12 inches long, and that they needed to use a mix of both uppercase and lowercase. And this was hugely controversial at the time, because there was a strong opinion that using block capitals would be the clearest option. But actually, when we think about it, none of this is anything that we think about anymore, because it just goes to show how really well designed these signs are, that they aren't causing problems anymore, and that we have not only adopted them universally across the country, but we have also started to see, we also saw that other countries were starting to use Jock Kinnear's research and methods to support their ideas. Now, once we'd sorted out signs and making sure that they weren't going to be distracting and that they were placed at a particular angle, that only the driver had to look 15 degrees away from the road for them to be able to make those signs out, we then needed to think about what was happening around our roads. Because we didn't want our drivers distracted and thinking about what was going on outside of these little roads. So motorways can feel quite isolating, as a result, but this was all very much intentional. We have big rows of trees, as you can likely see alongside me if you're watching on the YouTube channel, of trees alongside the large majority of our motorways, and that's no mistake. A lot of our motorways were suddenly going through very pastoral, very beautiful areas of the country. For example, the M25 Orbital goes through some of the biggest green spaces and the green belt in that area at the time when it was introduced. And that was deemed to be quite distracting and having the potential for our drivers who were driving at speeds that they'd never really driven at before, looking over, admiring, enjoying their surroundings, rather than focusing on the potential dangers that they were going to have in front of them. And so they started to not only clear some areas either side of the road for these trees for the drivers, but also it was a good way of trying to prevent some of the pollution and things that they were noticing coming from the road going into these natural green areas and causing problems in the environment and the ecosystems there. So we've really got a lot of thought process going into the creation of these roads that now a lot of people try and avoid because we think about them as being quite congested and things like that. But the reality is that's possibly because they're not being used as they were intended. They were intended as being a very safe space for a lot of cars, and that we have just continued to add on, and we've lost potentially some of the green space on the sides of some of these roads. We've seen more distractions being introduced for drivers, for example, variable speed limits and the closing of lanes quite suddenly without cones and things like that, which can be actually more noticeable for drivers. And so it's an argument potentially to be made that the reason things like smart motorways aren't working is because they don't fit in with the original very well thought out and well researched signage and design that our original motorways were set up to have. I personally really enjoy a good drive on a motorway, especially in Peggy. I know that there's an argument for these motorways creating something called highway hypnosis, where you get so kind of focused in on the road and the lack of distractions that you zone out from your driving. But when I'm driving Peggy, I find that I'm actually much safer on a motorway than I am driving a modern car. And I actually enjoy the kind of comfort of being able to potentially sit behind a particular lorry for a little bit and then eventually go for an overtake when I feel safe to do so and I want a different kind of viewpoint. We're actually about to just pull off the A1N now, so that seems like a good time to wrap up today's podcast. I hope you've enjoyed my little thought processes about the motorway and potentially you've learned something. And next time that you're driving along a motorway, you find yourself spotting these things and noticing those signs and markers that you hadn't previously really given much thought to. It's a real credit to the designers that actually these things all seem so natural to us 50 odd years later. And that a lot of the time these roads are still very useful for individuals driving cars that were around at the time when they were first introduced. That by no means means that I don't enjoy a nice little back road adventure, but sometimes it can be really quite efficient, and that is exactly what our motorways were originally designed for. So thank you ever so much for listening. I'd love to hear your thoughts about motorways and the things you've learned in today's podcast in the comments or via the messages on my Instagram page. Drive safely and happy motoring.